morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbirds have spoken like the first day. Friends, praise the Lord. Good morning and welcome to the sunrise with Jesus. Have you realized that every sunrise is a sound and light show? As the sun rises, the birds are singing. So friends, today we're going to look at the beautiful celebration of music that is so much at the heart of Christmas. We're going to think about this. How much more beautiful would the world be if we sang more and complained less? How much more beautiful will our relationships be if we sang to each other in hymns and spiritual songs as the scripture invites us to? And can you for a moment pause to think, how empty would Christmas be if there was no singing at all? Well, all the more reason for us to make singing a way of praying and praising and speaking and breathing. Friends, there is so much music to Christmas. The silver bells, the carolers, the angelic choirs, and all setting out to recreate that beautiful Christmas herald where the choirs of angels came down to the earth proclaiming the good news with grand singing. They sang Gloria in Excelsis Deo, and not to an audience of kings and presidents, but to simple shepherds lying frozen in the open fields of Bethlehem. They were frozen with fear, frozen with the cold, but when they heard the angels singing, a fire was stirred in their hearts and they rushed singing that chorus all the way to the stable in Bethlehem. And guess what? That night, someone else was singing. Mother Mary was holding the tiny king and she was singing her first lullaby. She was singing, "Sleep, my little baby, sleep, O Almighty King. My heart has a joyful tone, for my arms is your lowly throne." Mother Mary was a woman of praise, a woman who we know for sure would have been singing for Jesus every night to put him to sleep. We remember how she makes that long and difficult journey in the early months of her pregnancy. And when she reaches her cousin's home, Elizabeth, that meeting and greeting was a form of praise and worship. Elizabeth praising God for what was happening with Mother Mary, the promise of ages being fulfilled, and Mother Mary opening her mouth only to sing out the Magnificat, as we call it. The song recorded in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, verse 46, where she sings out, "In the tradition of the good and holy and God-fearing Jews," she sings out, "My soul magnifies the Lord." And as she is singing God's praises, the baby John in the womb of his mother is leaping for joy. In this meeting, we are seeing a new culture of spirit-filled celebration. Friends, this is a time when we all will be meeting and celebrating. And St. Paul, in the letter to the Ephesians, chapter 5, verses 18, 19, 20, he says, "When you meet, don't be drunk with alcohol, but be filled with the Spirit." And what does such a celebration mean? In verse 19, he says, "Address each other with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, making melody in your heart for the Lord." Friends, here, this is what we see Mother Mary and Elizabeth doing in their meeting and their greeting, praising God with songs and spiritual words. when we look at the singing of Mother Mary, the singing of the Magnificat, we must know it was not just an emotional outburst, but in fact, she was singing a spiritual song. She was singing from a scripture text. The song of the Magnificat was in fact sung by Hannah, the mother of the prophet Samuel. When she is blessed with a child, she cries out singing, "My soul magnifies the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God, my Savior." When we look at this background into just this one song of Mother Mary, we realize that as we look deeper into the tradition of the Jews, into the Old Testament tradition, we see right from the earliest of times that the people of God were trained to sing to each other, recounting what God has done, recounting great deeds. Instead of complaining, they were called to praise God. So right in the first instructions that God gave to his people through Moses was this, that the people should recount the praises of God, and which is what you see to this day in the prayers of the Shema, where they cry out five times a day, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God is one God, and thou shalt love the Lord with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your strength." And it continues to recount how in every generation God heard the prayers of his people, and God saved them in their distress, and God blessed them with abundant graces. We see in every song a passing on of faith. We see in every song an encouragement. We remember how when Moses and the people of Israel cross the Red Sea, they take out the tambourine and the lyre, and they are singing and praising God. Praising is essential to worship. So when we look at the way there is this singing in the scriptures, there are some things that you and I must know, so we can prepare even now as we head to the grand feast of the Christmas, so that we can enter the celebration singing with the angels, with Mother Mary and Joseph and the shepherds, and maybe a different tune with the wise men. The first thing we realize about singing spiritual songs is this, that this is essential to true worship. The Word of God tells us that we shall love the Lord with all our heart, with all our mind, with all our strength, and with all our being. Now, friends, it is through singing that we allow the worship to rise above being just a mental exercise. We rise above to include our heart, our body, our vocal cords, and our entire being, raising a tune to God. When we sing and we sing for the Lord, friends, we tend to lose all our distractions. We tend to get rid of all those things that could be coming in the way of us reaching out to God. We even forget ourselves. That is what singing hymns does for us. It leads us to connect to God Himself. Secondly, we see that in the earliest of times, and right up to where we see in the New Testament, Mother Mary singing psalms and hymns, they learned the scripture by singing hymns. Well, so many of us, we have learned several verses because they were put to music. And we know this, that Mother Mary must have taught Jesus scriptures by singing to him. And at different moments in the life of Jesus, you hear him crying out, singing out the Psalms, because these were so ingrained within his heart. Even while he is crucified, he sings the Psalm 22. My God, why have you forsaken me? There is a tradition of singing the prayers, singing the word of God, because when we sing certain words, it does not get erased from our memory so easily. So this is a time-tested tradition for you and I to find the way to live in the Word and to allow the Word to dwell in us. St. Paul writes in the letter to the Colossians, chapter 3, verse 16, he says, "Let the Word of God dwell richly in you. Teach and admonish one another," and he says, "sing spiritual songs, sing the Psalms, sing out praises." And so we must know, if we need the Word of God to be rooted in us and to bear fruit in us, we need to be singing the Word of God. Next, for us to pray unceasingly, Scripture calls us to pray unceasingly. And what is praying unceasingly? It is to ensure that our spirit is breathing. If our body stops breathing for a few minutes, well, we could actually die. But friends, could we be having a dying spirit because we are not praising God enough? And this is the beauty of singing. When we sing, long after we have stopped singing with our tongues, the melody is playing in our hearts. We are making that music in our hearts, and throughout the day, that music keeps running in our heart and our head, and we are remaining in the presence of God. The Word of God is nourishing every layer of our thinking, our imagination, and our living. The church, moreover, tells us that during the Eucharistic celebration, there should be singing, and it should be a singing where the entire community can participate. Why so? Because singing binds us together. When we come for the Holy Mass and the choir is singing a beautiful song, we are not there to watch a concert. Of course, if we do not know the song, we can listen and pray with it. That's how it begins. But every one of us should be able to lend our voices. It is then that truly our community becomes a praying, a worshiping community. And remember, God dwells in the praises of His people. We are not there just to offer an intellectual assent that, okay, God, you are God, and so I am here. But we are there to worship Him, to welcome Him, and to honor Him. And that is why we need to sing together in moments when we gather for worship. Friends, let me tell you something very important. For God, it is not so much your singing ability that counts. Well, an ability to sing is a great talent, because those who have the ability to sing can lead others to sing to God. But, friends, the prime purpose of singing is to offer a love song to God, to offer worship to God, and which is why Scripture tells us, "Sing unto the Lord a new song." Sing to God with all your heart. Sing praises to your God. Right through the Scripture, you see exhortations to sing out to God. And so, friends, the quality of our singing depends on what the disposition of our heart is, not so much about the capability of our tones and our voices and our range, or even our musical abilities. What matters is, are you singing to the God? The blackbird that caws, the frog that croaks, are all offering praise to God. To you and me, the nightingale may sound better, but for God, He is glorified when all of creation rises to worship Him with whatever sounds they have to offer. Friends, look at Saint Augustine. He offers us something very precious. He says, "One who sings prays twice." So instead of saying, "Oh God, hear my prayer, hear my prayer," When you say, "Hear my prayer, O Lord," what are you doing? You are singing twice. And this is the invitation of the angels of Christmas. Not just to listen to that good news, but to allow that good news to resound through our lives and through our voices. It has been said that a day in which you have not laughed is a day wasted. I'm not so sure about that, because laughing is something spontaneous. But a day in which we have not sung, and in which we have not sung to the Lord, is definitely a day that we have wasted. So let's ensure we make the most of this day, that we allow all the beauty of Christmas to fill today and every day. So what shall we do? We shall sing. Sing right through the day. Sing when you speak to one another. Even if you drive them a bit crazy, they will forgive you. Sing while you work. Sing through your tears. Sing out in praises. And yes, as we sing, we are joining the angels. We are joining Mother Mary. We are joining the hosts of heaven. We are joining the glorious choruses of praise that creation offers. We are joining to raise our hearts to offer something beautiful with our lives to our God, who is so worthy of our praises.
Mary was living in Nazareth, and every day Mary would have to go get water. Do you think that Mary, I'm going to ask the girls this, you guys, you didn't carry water anyway, so it doesn't matter. So do you think that Mary liked going every day and have to carry the water back and forth? You don't think so? I think she did. You know why? Because they didn't have WhatsApp. They didn't have texting. They didn't have Facebook. And where do you think the girls got together to talk? At the well. You guys, just for a hint, later in life, that's where the guys found their brides, at the well. Because that's where the girls were, at the well. You read in the Bible, almost every guy found his wife at a well. So watch out for these guys at wells. But let's imagine this. Mary comes back with a jug on her head. She sets it on the table with her mother. And all of a sudden, the cave is dark. Something's blocking the entrance of her cave. And she says, "Mother, something's in the entrance of the cave. I think I'll go see what it is." And she walks out of the cave with her dirty feet. And there in front of her is an archangel. His name is Gabriel. You see pictures of this. You get the impression that the angel says, "Hello, Mary, I'm here to make an announcement for you." I don't think so. I think the angel came to speak to Mary, and he had his face down on the ground and his wings were down, and he said, "Hail, full of grace." Why did the angel approach Mary? She's just a 15-year-old girl. She's not wearing a crown. She's got dirty feet. She's all covered with sweat from coming back and forth with the water. Why is the angel bowing down to the ground in front of Mary? Because he's a smart angel. He knows someday this little girl will be his boss. And Mary, when she spoke to the angel did not say, "Hail Mary." The name Mary is not there. We say that when we pray the rosary, but it doesn't say in the Bible, "Hail Mary." It just says, "Hail kahare tomene," hail full of grace. The word "full of grace" in the Greek, the original language, is kahare tomene. It's a Greek word that means past and present. It means you who have been made full of grace in the past, and who still remain full of grace at this moment. And then when the angel announces to Mary that she's going to have a baby, Mary says, "How will this be? Because I don't know a man. I haven't been with a man. How can I be pregnant?" And the angel said, it's the power of the Holy Spirit will overshadow you. This baby will not be from a man. It'll be a special one-time thing in all of human history where God is going to put this baby in you, and it'll be his son. He will be the father. Now, Mary is the Ark of the New Covenant. What's in Mary's womb? The Word of God, but not inscribed in stone. It's the Word of God in flesh. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Mary is the new Ark of the Covenant, and in her is the Word of God too, but it's the Word of God in flesh. Now, in the old Ark of the Covenant, there was also an urn. It was a dish with some of the manna from the wilderness. Some of the manna that came from the wilderness, they put that also in the Ark. What's in Mary's womb? Not the manna which came down from heaven, but Jesus said, I am the bread of life which came down from heaven. In Mary's womb is not only the Word of God inscribed in flesh, but also the bread of life which came down from heaven is in her womb. When Elizabeth saw Mary, she saw the Ark of the New Covenant. She said, who am I that the mother of my Lord should come to me? That was 100% human and 100% God, and God had become man.
God, you have drawn us into your presence.
You always draw those whom you desire into your presence, God. And this morning we know we are in your presence, not because of our noble decisions. So often we made decisions and we could not keep those decisions. But today, God, we are here because in your love, you drew us through your cords of compassion. You drew us, O God, into your presence. To feast in your glory. Jesus, we always want to remain in your presence. For though we are weak, in you is our strength. Jesus, this day, wherever we go, we want to find our strength in you. Let us look at this promise. This promise in Isaiah chapter 40. Listen to this promise and accept it as a strength that will raise you up in the presence of God. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is God. He is the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not grow faint or weary. And his knowledge is beyond our understanding. He it is who gives power to the weak, abundant strength to those who are fainting. And though young men faint and grow weary, and youth stagger and fall, they that wait on the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar as on eagle's wings. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not grow faint. They that hope in the Lord, they that wait on the Lord, they whose eyes are on God, they will renew their strength. They will soar as on eagle's wings. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not grow faint. Our strength is in the presence of God. Our strength is that we hope in Jesus. Jesus, we pray. Jesus be the center of our lives.
Jesus be the center of our life. Jesus be the center of my life.
Now and every moment of this day.
From beginning to the end, it will always be and it's always been you, Jesus.
Jesus.
Jesus, Jesus be the center of my life.
Jesus be the center.
Jesus be the center of my life.
From beginning to the end.
From beginning to the end. It will always be and it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus, from my heart to the heavens, Jesus be the center.
It's all about you.
All about you. Yes, it's all about you. From my heart to the heavens. all about you. Yes, it's all about you.
Lord, it is all about you. Every word I speak today, every moment, every thought. God, as we kneel in your presence, we pray, be the center of our lives. Be enthroned. Be the power in our weakness. Be the light in our way. Jesus, be the center.
Jesus, be the center of my life.
Jesus, I adore you.
Jesus, be the center of my life.
Jesus, I adore you.
From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus.
Jesus.
Sacrament most holy, oh sacrament divine, all praise and all thanksgiving.